looked at Mendel's first law and seen how it applies to the segregation of alleles during meiosis, and Mendel's second law, which applies to, and lets us understand how alleles that govern different traits mostly are segregating independently of each other. Now, if you can imagine, historically speaking, when biologists rediscovered Mendel's laws, Mendel published his paper in an obscure journal, and he died before anyone really appreciated the discoveries that he had made. But when he was discovered in the very early 1900s, his work was rediscovered. Investigators immediately knew about the cytological work that had described the behavior of chromosomes during mitosis and during meiosis. So they immediately started to put two and two together here and realized that, in fact, the chromosomes might be the rafts upon which the Mendelian determinants, the Mendelian alleles, floated. And, of course, we know that that's true. We know that Mendel's alleles are different versions of genes and that those genes are born on the DNA of chromosomes. But historically speaking, this was quite a breakthrough in making that tie. And for us and for you who are just learning about the basics of classical Mendelian transmission genetics, it's very useful to put Mendel's laws and the behavior of Mendelian alleles in the context of the behavior of chromosomes during meiosis, especially, and mitosis for that matter. So let's look at a genes or alleles eye view of mitosis and meiosis. So first let's tackle mitosis. So here we have a pair of homologous chromosomes. One chromosome is bearing now the large A allele, and one is bearing the small A allele. Again, these are homologs. So this would be a heterozygous individual, a big A, little a heterozygote. Well, as mitosis proceeds, we have mitotic metaphase, in which the replicated chromosomes line up on the metaphase plate, and then we have anaphase, telophase, and cytokinesis of mitosis, and that results in two cells. One cell inherits this top chromosome here and this top chromosome here. That would be this top cell here at the end of mitosis. And the bottom cell inherits this bottom sister chromatid and this bottom sister chromatid here, so that we get two cells, each of which are still heterozygous, big A, little a, big A, little a, which is what mitosis does. Barring mutation, it produces two daughter cells that are genetically identical to the parental cell. Well, now let's look at meiosis. And let's look at a single allele, a single gene rather, with two alleles present on a pair of homologous chromosomes. Dealing with meiosis now. So this is a big S, little s heterozygote, diploid. We have replication during the S phase of the cell cycle prior to the first meiotic division. So we have two sister chromatids now that have little s and two sister chromatids that have big S. And then as meiosis proceeds, the first meiotic division, we have separation of the homologous chromosomes. So we have one product of meiosis, one has the two sister chromatids bearing big S and the other with two sister chromatids that bear little s. And then in meiosis II, the chromatids separate in a mitotic-like way so that this cell produces two daughter cells, each of which has a single chromosome bearing the little s allele. And this, these two cells have a single chromosome bearing the big S allele derived from this cell in meiosis II. So here we have four haploid gametes, two bearing big S and two bearing little s. And this matches up very well with Mendel's first law, that at the time of reproductive cell formation, the Mendelian determinants, the alleles, segregate independently of each other, uninfluenced in any way by each other, as single copies into gametic products. And so the behavior here of the chromosomes explains how, provides the mechanical basis, rather, for the segregation of Mendelian alleles according to Mendel's first law. So that all fits very nicely. Well, now let's look at the case where we have, we'll look at two traits or two different genes with alleles separately. So in this case, we're looking at a double heterozygote, big A, little a, big B, little b, and we're indicating the homologous chromosomes with different colors here. So one pair of homologs is blue and red, the other pair is magenta and green. And we have replication in the S phase prior to meiosis, where each chromosome becomes replicated and consists of two sister chromatids. That's true for all four of these chromosomes here. So this would then represent meiosis I metaphase. And as anaphase in meiosis I proceeds, this chromosome will go north, this chromosome will go north, this chromosome will go south, and this chromosome goes south here, so that at the end of meiosis I, we end up with two products, each of which has replicated chromosomes, in this case, a chromosome having two sister chromatids, each bearing the big A allele, and a chromosome consisting of two sister chromatids, each bearing the big B allele. And likewise, for this cell of a meiotic I product, we have a chromosome with two sister chromatids bearing little a, and a chromosome with sister chromatids each bearing little b. Well, then let's proceed through meiosis, and we see that at the meiosis II metaphase, then, the separation of the chromatids will occur. This sister chromatid will go north, this sister chromatid south, this one north, this sister chromatid south. Same for this product cell of meiosis I. Now at meiosis II, this chromatid will go north, that chromatid will go south, north and south again, such that each of these two cells now produce two daughter cells, and we have the following arrangement of alleles in those daughter cells. We have one pair of daughter cells bears the chromatids that have big A and big B together, and the other two produced by this bottom cell here produces a gametic product that has little a and little b, and another one that has little a and little b. Problem with this, though, isn't there? Because the genotypes of these gametes are of two types, big A, big B, and little a, little b, two of each. But wait a second. According to Mendel's law of independent assortment, we should actually get four possible genotypes of gametes resulting from this particular dihybrid genotype. So let's look at that. Remember, in the case where we were dihybrid for R alleles and for Y alleles, we generated four possible combinations of gametes in the meiotic process, or we should have. We should have had sperm and eggs with big R with big Y, big R with little y, little r with big Y, and little r with little y. But here we've only shown We've only shown two types of genotypes of gametes. So what has gone wrong? Was Mendel wrong? Am I wrong? What's going on here? Well, you have to remember that because these alleles are being born on chromosomes, the chromosomes can line up with respect to each other on in different ways at the meiosis I metaphase plate, such that we could get the green and magenta alleles lined up opposite each other in such a way that the green chromosome would be on the same side in the meiosis I cell as the blue, and the magenta as the red. That is, the green and magenta chromosomes can line up on the metaphase plate of meiosis I completely independently of the other chromosome homologous pair here, such that we could have these two meiotic I product cells, a cell in which contained the replicated homolog containing big A, and one containing the replicated little b sister chromatids, and vice versa for the red and magenta chromosomes. And in that case, what we end up with are four gametic products, half of which have big A with little b, and half of which have little a with big b. So in 50% of the meioses, these will be the meiotic products. And that, so half our gametes will be, or one quarter of our gametes will be big A with little b, and little a with little b. And one quarter of the gametes will be excuse me, 1/4 of the gametes will be big A with big B and little a with little b. So we will have 4 gametic products possible, and that is due to the independent assortment of Mendelian alleles because of the independent assortment of chromosomes, that alleles carried on one homologous chromosome pair will assort completely independently of alleles carried on another chromosome pair. And therein lies the basis for Mendel's second law of independent assortment. And this is now readily understandable, how we generate these 4 different types of arrangements of alleles in the case of, let's say, a dihybrid, due to the independent assortment of chromosomes. And that is where we will pick up with next time, with building upon Mendel's laws and the transmission of alleles via those laws, to look at some apparent exceptions to Mendel's rules, but not real exceptions to Mendel's rules. So we'll look at some special cases, some extensions to Mendelian genetics, in other words.